Shenanga. Welcome, 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 KFCC family and friends. Listen, it's another day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's enter into his presence with thanksgiving in our hearts. Amen, amen. This is another day that the Lord has made. Get excited. Get excited because you're walking amongst the living. God blew his breath into your body and saw fit and had purpose for your life today. So it is not by mistake that you are with us tonight. So do us a favor. Feel free to go ahead and share. Go ahead and share. And even start a watch party. If you know how to start a watch party, go ahead and start a watch party so your family, friends, and coworkers can watch right along with you. You know what? I dare to say even your enemies. Go ahead and invite your enemies because God will set up a table before your enemies to cause them to be a blessing to you and watch you be blessed. Amen? Amen. Let's take a moment and just go right ahead and share. Let's go ahead and share. We're waiting for Bishop Logan to come, and he's got a word from the Lord on tonight, and it is a divine appointment for someone tonight. So make sure that you use him like never before, Lord God. Use him mightily, Lord God, in whatever way you want to use him, God. We ask now in Jesus' precious and mighty name, God, that a divine appointment, Lord God, a Kairos moment, God, will happen for someone right where they are watching, God. We thank you, Jesus, now in advance, God. Before it even happens, God, we worship you and we thank you. We praise you now, God. We honor your presence and we worship you in spirit and in truth, God. Not for what we see, God, but for who you are. We thank you now in Jesus' precious and mighty name. Touch this service. Let someone be healed, set free and delivered, Lord God, out of bondage tonight. Suddenly, God, do something suddenly, Father. We come with high expectations of who you are, God, and we thank you for you showing up and showing out, God. We thank you for you being Lord over our lives, God. In Jesus' precious and mighty name, Lord God, we thank you for the anointing, God, now that breaks the yokes. We thank you, God, for the anointing that breaks the yokes, and we just ask now that you would have your way like never before, God. In Jesus' precious and mighty name, God. Go right ahead and type amen. Go right ahead and type amen. Again, if you happen not to be a part of the KFCC family and you would like to sow, feel free. You are not obligated to, but feel free, and we'll give you all that information towards the end. Amen. Here is Bishop Logan.
Well, bless the Lord. I was talking about this camera right here, sir. Amen. We're glad to receive you tonight. This is a great day to deal with the Word of God. I hope that your day has been a good one. If this is your first time being with us in this study on 1 Peter, this study is entitled Walk the Talk. Walk the Talk. And this is our third session. And it's entitled An Appetite for Being Good. This is a good way to move a little further from where we were last week. If you've been with us, our first session of this Bible study, which I would say to everybody, I'm grateful to the authors of this Bible study. I've borrowed heavily from it, taken it, and made it my own. But the first session was entitled The Battle for Holiness. And then last week, we talked about when you don't feel like being good, and we tied being good to being obedient. And so tonight, we're going directly from there to talking about how to develop an appetite for being good, or as I just stated, an appetite for walking in obedience. It is my prayer that this will be of benefit to you, particularly in this season in which we find ourselves. So go ahead and get your Bibles, if you would, please, and turn in them to the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, and we are going to be reading verses 1 through 12 of 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. Verses 1 through 12. 1 through 12. Minister, if you would quickly walk around the corner just in case our midweek attendee is there. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. Peter writes, "Therefore, putting aside all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. Y'all not moving the text. Move to the third one. Go to the next one now. If you have tasted the kindness of the Lord. I want to start reading that again. Go back to the first verse and stick with me. Go back to the first verse. Go two slides back. One more. There you go. Now, I'm going to start reading there, and I want you to stay with me, okay? All right? Okay. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, putting aside all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. If you have tasted the kindness of the Lord, and coming to him as to a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For this is contained in Scripture. Behold, I lay in Zion a choice stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed. This precious value, then, is for you who believe. But for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected, this became the very cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. For they stumble because they are disobedient to the word, and to this doom they were also appointed. This is one of my favorite verses. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For you once were not a people, but now you are the people of God, and you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, because of your good deeds, as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation. We're talking about tonight developing an appetite for being good, developing an appetite for obedience. The Apostle Peter tells us to crave spiritual milk. Crave spiritual milk. Now, Peter wasn't writing these words to new believers only. His letter was written to all kinds of Christians at every imaginable level of maturity. I want to tell you something. No matter how long you have been a believer, there's only one way to grow in your salvation, and that is to become spiritual. And you're not going to like this, and master the art of obedience. The only way to grow in your salvation, to become spiritual and master the art of obedience, is through pure spiritual milk. So this study tonight, I'm going to examine four basic elements that contribute to our spiritual growth. And if you and I make these things a part of our daily living, then we will develop an appetite for obedience. Now, why is that so? Because when a baby is born, all the nutrition that that newborn infant needs is found in his or her mother's milk. The child grows and develops as it should exclusively on a diet of their mother's milk, and this goes on for several months. But eventually there comes a time when this child has to move on to other things, like strained vegetables or bottled baby food, or like we used to do, formula mixed with some cereal in a bottle. And then, of course, it isn't long after that before they are eating mashed potatoes, corn, hot dogs, Happy Meals, and pizza. And so though it only lasts a short period of time, there it's a period of time when the baby can thrive on nothing but a diet of pure milk. Now, while a baby will eventually outgrow its need for pure milk, you and I as believers, we never do. Because there are some basic elements of spiritual nurture, and Peter calls them pure spiritual milk. It's this pure spiritual milk that all Christians need to grow spiritually. But even 10, 20, 30, and 40 years later, the Christian still needs pure spiritual milk. Pure spiritual milk. We go deeper by rehearsing or by doing the basics over and over again. So, Bishop, I hear you asking, what are the basics that you're talking about? Well, that brings me to number one. Here's number one. Read the Bible. Oh, that's deep, isn't it? That is so deep. Bishop, I thought you were going to give us something super deep. No, we're talking basics. And the first of the basics is read the B-I-B-L-E, read the Bible. Look again at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 24 and 25. Peter writes, "For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of the field. The grass withers, and the flower falls off. But the word of the Lord endures forever." And this is the word which was preached to you. I think a lot of people, some of them Christians, think that it's just good Christians who read the Bible. But actually, they've got the equation backwards. It's really the people who read the Bible who become good Christians. Why? Because the Bible is God's word to us. This word tells us how to live. It challenges us. It motivates us. It comforts us. It encourages us. It inspires us. When you and I read the Bible, we become changed by its influence. Admittedly, this is a big if we read it with a heart that is willing to be taught. Now, I believe Joel Osteen still does it, and I used to do it when I would preach around the country, and sometimes I would go back to those places and I didn't do it. The moment I stood up to preach, people were standing up with their Bibles in the air, and they'd hold their Bibles in the air, and they'd say something like, "This is my Bible. It is the word of the Lord." And then they would go on by ending up by saying that they were teachable. It will do all those things I said. It will influence us if we read it with hearts that are willing to be taught. I'm sure most of us, maybe even all of us, have known people who seemed to know a lot of Bible verses. But they only used those Bible verses as ammunition against other people. And they were missing the point of reading the Bible. We don't read the Bible to find out what's wrong with everybody else. We read the Bible to find out what's wrong with us. And so when we read the Bible, we should read the Bible with an attitude that says something like, God, what is it that you are saying to me? What do I need to know? What do I need to do? What do I need to change about the way I think or the way I act? Is there a sin I need to confess? Is there a promise that I need to believe? Is there an action I need to avoid? Is there a commandment I need to obey? Is there an example I need to follow? So when Peter writes about pure spiritual milk, what he's really referring to is the Word of God. And Peter is saying that we should have a strong desire for the Word of God because we need it. And we will never outgrow our need for its daily input in our lives. I've told this story a number of times. I'm one of these people that I tend to go through Bibles over the course of time. And over the course of time, as I use a Bible, the pages become increasingly worn. The pages become colorful as I highlight and I underline. This is a brand new Bible that I have here, and I haven't even written my name in the front of it. I haven't written on any of the pages. It's a clean Bible. But when my Bible gets worn, and the binder begins to fall off, I don't throw it away. I retire it to my bookshelf. And sometimes, as an interesting exercise, I will flip back through those old Bibles to see what I wrote in the margins. Sometimes they're notes from sermons that I was listening to. Sometimes it's notes that I wrote as I was reading. Generally, it was rare to find a couple pages like this, when you open the Bible just like this. Generally, it was rare to find two pages like that where there was nothing highlighted or underlined. This one day, as I was flipping through one of those Bibles, I came across where of the two pages, only one of them had anything underlined on it. And it was a verse of Scripture that said this: "You have been rebellious ever since I've known you." Care to venture a guess what was God's word to me that day? "You have been rebellious ever since I've known you." When we crave the pure spiritual milk, we will never outgrow our need for it. So the first thing that we do in terms of getting back to the basics is we read the Bible. Here's the second thing. Mr. Howard, I'm so glad you're here tonight because he's here with me every Wednesday. But as he directs our area of music and marketing and multimedia, here's the second basic. Go to my second point. Here's my second one. Declare God's praise. Declare God's, another one that's not real deep, and yet it is. You see, generally, and I know that the pandemic has changed this for a lot of people, but you still, most of you, you'll tune in on Sunday to worship services. And having the ability to now surf, you can go from one worship service to another worship service to another worship service to another worship service. But generally, we come together on a weekly basis to worship God. That's why we come together. And in that worship, we will sing songs of praise. We will offer up prayers. And that's, I cannot emphasize how important a part that is of living the Christian life. Even the Apostle Paul said that we ought not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. Something happens when we come together. There's a synergy that takes place when believers come together and we combine our praise together and we agree in prayer one with the other. However, the praise and worship that takes place in church should only be a small part of the role that praise should take in our daily lives. The Bible challenges us to praise God continually throughout our days. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Peter writes, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession," note this, "so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." You see, we were created to praise God, not just one day a week, but we were created to praise God every single day. And let me tell you something. The more we praise God, the easier it's going to be to master the art of obedience. Did you hear that? The more we praise God, the easier it's going to be to master the art of obedience. And there are primarily two ways to declare God's praise. Here's the first way. You declare God's praise by telling it to God. Go to the next verse, the slide. Two ways to declare God's praise. First way is that you tell it to God. Did you hear that? Tell it to God. What do I mean by that? I mean, say to God the things that you know to be true about him. Things like, "God, you're so wonderful. You are so full of mercy and forgiveness and love. You are the source of truth and light and everything that is good. God, you are faithful to me even when I am unfaithful. God, you forgive me even though I don't deserve to be forgiven. You answer my prayers even though I sometimes don't answer your call. God, you are my only hope." Those are the types of things that we should be saying to God. Now, granted, God already knows these things to be true. So what are we doing when we declare God's praises? What are we doing when we tell it to God? We're not giving him any new information. We're not boosting his self-esteem. We're not buttering him up. We're not trying to fool him in any way. But when we tell it to God, what we are in fact doing is we're strengthening our relationship with him. But secondly, declaring God's praise means not only that you tell it to God, but that you tell it to others. If you have ever shared your faith with another person, you probably already know that some people have a tendency to put up a wall of resistance. Whenever you begin to share God's word with them, they think you're about to preach to them. They think they're about to get a sermon. They are afraid they are about to be dumped on with a load of guilt and then pressured into doing something they are afraid to do. Listen, let me tell you something. Even though there is a close connection between evangelistic outreach and sales, God didn't ask us to be salespeople. Let me say that again. God didn't ask us to be salespeople. God asked us to declare his praises. And declaring his praises is not just when we tell it to God, but it's also when we tell others about God. When we tell others about how good he is, about what God has done for us, about how much God means to us. You see, it's easy to talk to others about God when you're really talking to them about God. It's when we begin to slip into the salesperson mode that people begin to throw up walls of resistance. You see, sharing our faith is much more effective when we emphasize to others how good God is rather than how bad they are. You see, that's what it means to declare his praises. And as we declare God's praises to him and to others, we will discover that our appetite for obedience increases dramatically. Look at that next verse, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 through 10. I read it already. We're going to read it again. "But you are a chosen race, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. This is from the King James Version. And verse 10, go to the, which in time you were not a people, but now you are the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Two ways to declare God's praises. Tell it to God. Tell it to others. But that brings me to number three. Here's the third piece. Go ahead. Identify with God's people. Identify with God's people. Go to the next slide. This text, I just read it. I'll read it again from the New American Bible, New American Standard. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. Do you think after some point you might get this in your spirit? Because we're repeating it. So that you may declare the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. I need for you to understand something, that as fellow believers in Christ Jesus, we are part of the most important group of people on the entire planet. I'm not saying that we are better than anyone else, but we have the most important job to do. And the fact that I believe that we have come under judgment is proof positive that we have not been doing that important job. Oh yeah, we have flashes in the pan over the generations. Even here in Charlotte, one of our main big hospitals was Presbyterian Hospital. But Presbyterian Hospital has disappeared now under a corporate conglomerate name called Novant. It used to be, as you traveled around the country, that there were hospitals that all had names of Christian organizations or Baptist Hospital, Catholic hospitals. They carried with them, if you will, the name of Christ. The same thing is true of colleges, schools that were church schools. Even the Presbyterian Church as a denomination had an incredible history of evangelistic outreach worldwide. But today, at least that mainline denomination, I'm not talking about some of those that have remained faithful, but that mainline denomination of which I used to be a part, I believe has Ichabod. Ichabod means glory has departed, written across its doorpost, because it has left its first love. We've had flashes in the pan of it, but most of these things have been taken over by nonprofit organizations because we have ceased to declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Used to be schools and daycare centers, homeless shelters, orphanages, nursing homes, soup kitchens that all operated in the name of Jesus Christ. And right now we're beginning to see many of those disappear. In fact, we even know as a result of the pandemic, there are a lot of churches that once this pandemic is over, they will never open their doors again. If they were to disappear completely, our world would become unbearable. But I want to tell you tonight that many of the things that distress you the most, that distress me the most, as we watch our world seemingly going to hell in a handbasket, has happened because we have stopped identifying with God's people. You see, we have to get back to the realization and let other people know that it is Jesus Christ who is the glue that holds our world together. And even though this world tends not to recognize it, we are the people of God that have a crucial role to play in our society. We're a part of what God is doing. We are his hands. We are his feet. We need to continue to align ourselves with fellow followers of Christ and not go along with what is happening in our world just so that we can get along. We need to align ourselves with the people who are precious to God and essential to the well-being of a global community. We're not the only believers. My God, we have sisters and brothers who are completely on the other side of the world, whom you have never met, whom I have never met, and perhaps we never will. My wife and I are just in a few more days getting ready to leave to go to Africa, to a part of Africa I have never been in, and a part of Africa, and the continent of Africa my wife has never been in. And we're going to be with sisters and brothers in the body of Christ. And we will not be strangers, even though we have not met. Why? Because we are a people, we're part of the same body of Christ. We are a people who are precious to God. We are a people with a vital mission. And when we focus on that mission, which is to identify with the people of God, when we focus our attention on the fact that we are part of God's people, we are part of a people with a purpose, we will find that our appetite for obedience grows. Hallelujah. You know, the great thing about social media can be an incredible instrument for evil, but it's also an incredible instrument for good. You can surf across, watch Facebook. You can surf across YouTube and find ministries coming out of all different parts of the world. Many of them are in English, so you can follow them. And you know what you discover? They're singing songs that you recognize. And then you recognize, hey, they're singing songs. Wow, that's awesome. Man, I need to get to Minister Howard to make sure that he learns that, because that's an incredible piece of music in terms of praising God. They're worshiping and praising God because we are a precious people to God. So the way that we begin to develop an appetite for being good is, one, reading the Bibles; two, declaring God's praise; three, identifying with God's people. But that brings me to a fourth way. Number four, avoid sinful situations. Avoid sinful situations. Peter writes in chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. He writes this. Go forward. Keep going. Oh, I didn't put it there. Okay, well, let me read it. Chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. And let me read that again. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. Can I put a pin right there for a second? Minister Howard, this is one of the things that many Christians do not understand. They're prone to say things like, this is a Christian nation. Or they have an unrealistic goal that we will make it a Christian nation. That we'll get it. No. Peter says here that we're aliens and strangers. And he urges us to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against our soul. There is so much out there in the world that has a draw and a pull for us. And listen, the things you see, the things you hear, the things you taste, they have no pull on you unless they appeal to your flesh. So my people, and I say it that way, my people, they know the one food that I actually absolutely positively will not eat is what? Beets. I will not eat beets. I don't care how many blue ribbons you won at the state fair, I'm not eating your beets. So you can set a whole table and prepare them 100 million different directions and have all kinds of people flooding to the table to taste them. I'm going to stand back because it does not have a draw on my flesh. I don't have to work to abstain from it. But there are some things I do have to work to abstain from, and no, I'm not going to tell you what they are because you all can't keep your mouth. Verse 12, he says, keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles. Gentiles, for Peter, were non-believers. So if I contemporize the text, is keep your behavior excellent among non-believers so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, because of your good deeds, as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation. So one of the things that we need to do in order to develop an appetite for being good, the last thing that we need to do is to avoid sinful situations. Now, let me describe this little thing. Guys, has your mother ever said anything like this? If you were asking for a snack and it was close to dinner time, did she ever say anything to you like, no, you're spoiling your appetite? Your mom ever said anything like that to you? Yes. The answer to that question is yes, of course. Minister Howard, did your mom say that to you growing up? I know my mom did. You asked for the first answer was no. But the reason was because you'll spoil your appetite. And it only makes sense because if you eat a bag of potato chips a half hour before mealtime, it will make you less hungry when it's time to eat. Now make the connection. Because in the exact same way, there are certain things in life that will spoil your appetite for obedience. Remember, the Bible says that sin is pleasurable. Yeah, it does. It says the pleasures of sin. That means sin is pleasurable. If sin were not pleasurable, there would not be so many people in it. The problem is that the pleasure of sin is short-lived. It's temporary. And it will spoil your appetite for obedience. Because that sin has this way of drawing you back to it. You ever found a dessert that you had never tasted before? And that dessert was so good that you would drive out of your way to the only store you knew sold it in order to get it. And that's what sin does. It'll keep you coming back because it's pleasurable. So the best thing that you can do is to avoid those things at all costs. There may be some things that you just have to eliminate. And not necessarily because they are sinful in and of themselves, but because those things lead you to sin. Okay, let me try it a different way. Some of you may have, when you went to college, got together with other students in playing certain card games. Card games like Bidwist and what's some of the others? Where you play with teams and things of that nature, huh? Spades, that's the big one. Now, somebody asked me one time, was it sinful to do that? And the answer is no, it's just a game. But for some, it may be a gateway back into sin because they didn't just play spades. There are other things that went along with it. You follow what I'm saying? And so there might be some things that you have to eliminate because even though they are not sinful in and of themselves, they led you to sin. Now, for me growing up, one of the favorite musicians favorite songwriters and singers to listen to when you wanted to get busy. We called him the Walrus of Love, Barry White. But Barry White, you know, unless you're talking about you and your spouse, that's a different story. But if you're single, that might be something you need to eliminate because of the door that it may open. I know you might say to yourself, I'm being silly, but I'm not. What I'm trying to tell you, if you find that listening to a certain kind of music or watching certain television programs or being with certain people provokes you to sin, then you need to avoid them at all costs. There's some people that you know every time you get around them, you slip back. I'm not saying stop loving them. You just may need to learn how to hold them at arm's distance. Love them from a distance. In other words, what I'm trying to tell you is do not spoil your appetite for being good. So if you and I are going to get good at being good, we need to find our nurture in the craving of pure spiritual milk. We need to excel in the basics. Excel in them because we'll never outgrow our need for the fundamentals of the Christian life. So we need to read the Bible. We need to declare God's praise. We need to identify with God's people. We need to avoid sinful situations. And when we come to the place that we begin to master these four simple, aren't they simple? They're simple. Simple principles, we're going to discover that our appetite for obedience grows. And we will be able to walk the talk according to the will of God. But that's what I want to leave you with tonight. Those four simple principles. Read the Bible. Declare God's praise. Identify with God's people. And avoid sinful situations. I hope you were blessed by that. And I pray even more that it helps somebody. Well, that's what I have for you tonight. I want to give you an opportunity to give before I pray for you tonight. This may have stirred up some things in people that I now need to close the door on spiritually. But just before I pray for you, I want to invite you to sow, particularly if you find that you're being blessed by these studies. We have multiple ways that you can give online. If you have the Givilify app on your electronic device, you can use it to give. You'll find us in Givilify. It's called Givilify, G-I-V-E-L-I-F-Y, Givilify. It's up on the screen. We are listed in there as Kingdom Fellowship Christian Center, Charlotte, North Carolina. Kingdom Fellowship Christian Center, Charlotte, North Carolina. You can also give through PayPal, and you can find us in PayPal as Kingdom Fellowship Christian Center as well. And in fact, I believe, Howard Jr., that there is a QR symbol that you can flash up on the screen for them. As I flash that QR symbol up, you can take your phone if you have that app on your phone. And that symbol will take you right to PayPal, where you can use PayPal to give. And then our third way of giving is with Cash App, the Cash App. The Cash App, our Cash App identification is $KingdomFellows, $KingdomFellows. Those are three ways that you can give online, and we welcome you to do so. May the Lord bless you as you give unto Him. So we thank God for that. Now, I want to pray for you. And as I pray for you tonight, there may be some of you who already know that these four principles have been difficult for you. You're not good at reading your Bible. You've not been good at declaring the praises of God who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You have not been good at identifying with God's people. It's one of the reasons you get into a lot of trouble is because you have a lot of ungodly friends. And, yeah, you have trouble avoiding sinful situations. Let me tell you something. You're not in this by yourself. God knew that you couldn't do this by yourself. So when Jesus ascended into heaven, he did not leave us alone. But he gave us the Holy Spirit, his Holy Spirit, who leads and guides us into all truth. This Holy Spirit is our comforter, is our keeper, is our guide. And so as I pray for you tonight, if your earnest request is, give me help in reading my Bible, if you ask it, God will honor that request and give you that help. If you're asking, Lord, help me to declare your praises, he'll honor that request. He'll honor the request for, God, point me to brothers and sisters in the body with whom I can fellowship and help me to change my circle of relationships. He'll honor that request. And if you know you struggle to avoid sinful situations, he can insulate you so that you can avoid those at all costs. God is so gracious and kind, and he will help you in each of those areas. So I encourage you tonight, I encourage you strongly to be honest with God. And as I pray for you tonight, yes, I'm praying for your healing. Yes, I'm praying for your deliverance. But most importantly tonight, I'm praying that you would be able to develop an appetite for obedience, an appetite for being good. So let's pray. Father, I just thank you right now for your graciousness, for your kindness, for your mercy. I thank you that when we pray, you hear us and you answer us. Especially now during this week of prayer that we here at KFCC are in the midst of as we pray around the clock. I pray that you would hear and honor the requests of your people as it relates to developing this appetite for being good. Lord, we are aware that you desire from us obedience more than you do our sacrifice. So even as we gave an opportunity for giving, we thank you for the privilege of giving, the opportunity to give. But we also recognize that the greatest gift that we can bring to you is our obedience. So I pray for my sisters and my brothers, particularly for those who have struggled, that you would help them to develop this appetite for being good. Lord, give them a desire to read and study your word. Help them to remember that there's five things we ought to do with your word. We need to read it, we need to hear it, we need to study it, we need to memorize it, and we need to meditate upon it. God, well up within them a desire deep down within to do all five of those things with your word. And then, oh God, help them to declare your praises. Lord, that when they pray to you, that they would tell you, oh God, how they feel about you, how blessed they are by you, how good you are to them, how awesome you are, how bad you really are. But not only that, but they would learn how to tell others about your goodness and your mercy. And then, oh God, that they would go beyond that and learn how to identify with other believers. Lord, forgive us when we have surrounded ourselves with those who do not share our values, who do not share our faith, and who have unwittingly we have allowed to influence us. Lord, we want to be influences, our influencers, not influenced. You called us to be salt and light. Help us to be that salt and light. And then, oh God, we want to be perfectly honest and admit before you and before others that we have been guilty of falling into the trap of sin simply because we've allowed ourselves to be in the wrong places at the wrong times. Lord, help us to avoid sinful situations. Help us to let our yes be yes and our no be no. And Satan, I call you by name. You're a liar and the truth's not in you. I put you on notice. This people belongs to God. Release them and let them go now in Jesus' name. And Lord, while we're praying, we pray for our nation. We pray, oh God, that you would continue to stay the hand of violence. We pray, oh God, that you would bring resolution to the presidential process. We pray, oh God, that you would cause your church to rise up in this hour and to be whom you have called us to be. God, let us be the church. Help us to rise beyond political differences and to remember that we are kingdom citizens, first and foremost, and we bless you for that. I pray for everyone who's sick within the sound of my voice. Thank you that you're Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals us. I thank you for delivering everyone who's bound up tonight. Turn around, oh God, that heart that is set on self-destruction. I pray for that one who is depressed. Lord, lift their heads tonight. And I bless you, oh God, that you will be with your people in this hour. And that you will hear and answer our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, get back to the basics. I love you. There's not a thing you can do about it. We will be back on Sunday. Amen. KFCC will be live streaming on Sunday. Tune in if you can't get here at 10 a.m. If you can get here, we are located at 2925 East Independence Boulevard in the Jones Building on the second floor. Park on the street or in the parking lot behind the building. Come in the front door, go up the elevator or the stairs, and somebody will be there to greet you, to welcome you, and to direct you into our worship center. And then tune back in on Wednesday night for another episode, session 4, of our study in 1 Peter. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. Until we minister to you again, good night and God bless you.